Okay, yeah, I started recording.
Thank you.
Hello, good morning everyone. Today, as decided, we will do with the core HR training for Fusion HCM. Now, I am not sure if you have received the agenda already. If you are able to view my screen, I'm showing the agenda at the moment. So I will go by each of the topics. Now, the main purpose of this training is to give an idea about not only the application, I mean not only the product, but how we should go about an implementation. So when we go to a client site, we get the requirements, then what kind of questions we should ask and where we should exactly start from. So this is majorly to give you an idea about how to map the requirements to the product. So it's easy to actually do the product, I mean to do the setups in the product, but the most difficult part is to do the solution mapping. So when we go to an implementation, the core HR is the basic of everything. Most of the time we don't do a core HR project as such. We do a talent management project, or we do a performance management, or we do a very small part of it like a talent review or goal management. But it doesn't matter what it is, the core HR forms the basis of everything. Even if it is payroll or absence, you have to start with the core HR. So it is like give you the training is basically to give you a basic idea about how to go about the core HR setup. Now, I'm sure there are a lot of people in this training who are using Fusion for the first time. So I will start from the very basics about how the Fusion application looks like as well. I mean, what we should do when we first get a Fusion link. Now, as we all know, Fusion is a cloud product. So there is no in-house setup for this. There is no database servers located at the client end for this. So when we go for an implementation at a client end, the client already will be having the Fusion link from Oracle. So if you're seeing my screen, the part that I'm highlighting is actually the link. Now, if you read it from the beginning up to this, this is known as the POD, P-O-D. It means platform on demand. Now, if you see this instance, this is actually the TransUSA's internal instance. Now, if you see, it says ECGG-test. So every client, when they go for implementation, they have to buy the product from Oracle. Oracle by default gives them two such pods. One is the test, another is the production or the live instance. So you can understand the moment we get the test instance, we can understand what is the production instance for this. Production instance will be just the same thing without the test. Entirely the same thing remains for the login. So the login link is this. If you see this, the thing that I'm highlighting with ECGG test, refs.us2oraclecloud.com homepage cases views welcome. This will be universal. Just the pod name changes with the client. Now when you open this link, the login page opens with ask for your user ID and password. Can you please go for mute because I'm getting a lot of background noise.
Right.
So when Oracle gives the pod first to the client, they give an username and password. Most of the time the client IT administrator is the account manager for the particular account. So that person's email address becomes the user ID and they give a first time password. Now this particular username is of an employee, but it's a it's kind of an implementation user which they give. So you will see that the username will be something like the first name dot last name at the rate the client name dot com. That is the user ID, and Oracle will give us a password. Now that particular account is like an implementation user account. It's not an employee account. So what they do is they create that user ID and they give the IT security administrator role to that account holder. Now what we need to do is when we first log in, we should create our own user and we should deactivate that particular user ID, because you remember when you actually go live, that particular account manager or whoever will also be migrated as an employee. So if we keep that particular user ID active, then there will be clash in the, during the data migration, because that person will also be migrated as an employee. So the same email address will exist for the implementation user as well as the actual employee who is being migrated. So now I will log in as an implementation user, and I will show you the implementation task where you should exactly go and where you should start from. Now, when you first log in, you will come across this kind of a page. This is called the simplified UI. On the right-hand side, you can see a lot of icons. Each of these icons have different functions with respect to the modules that you purchase or that you are provisioned to. Now, if you see on the left-hand side, there is an Oracle logo. When you go live, you can replace this with the client's logo. There is ways to do is when we go to the last part of the training, that is the personalization part, I will take you through how to replace that logo. But the logo that is on the sign-in page where we give the username and password, that particular logo cannot be changed because that is the branding of Oracle. Now, once you get the instance, if you see on the right-hand top, you will see the username, the name of the logged-in user. The first thing that you need to do is you need to go to the right-hand top and go to the setup and maintenance option, because this part is accessible to the person who is the owner of this IT security administrator role. And if you go to setup and maintenance, you see all the setup related activities. Now, when you first get the account, you need to go here, and there is something called offerings. Now, if you are from eBiz background, then you will know there are something called modules like core HR, time and labor, absence management, payroll. These are all modules. Now, modules are termed as offerings in Fusion, and the way they call it, like the terminologies have changed entirely over here. So if you see these boxes, this is a rotating frame. So if you click on each of them are actually offerings. So it depends on your client that which offerings that client has bought or which he is provisioned to. Now, if you see on the left hand side, there are three types of offerings. One is all. All offerings means all the modules or all the products that Oracle has. So if you do all, then definitely this will show a lot more options. Now, there are provision and there are subscribe. Provision is on the offerings for which the client has bought the license or for which the client is allowed to do the setup. For example, you have different provision or license for core HR, different for payroll, absences like that. And then there is subscribe. Subscribe is for all the offerings that the client has started the implementation or has enabled. Now, this particular section is actually a rotating frame. If you see the bar over here, there are actually 24 offerings, and if you move on the on your right hand side, you will it will highlight each of the offerings. Now when we talk about core HR or HR related projects like performance management, talent review and all, we deal with the offering called workforce deployment. It comes at the end. This is alphabetically arranged. So this is the offering that we will be dealing with. And if you are working for talent management, then there is another offering which comes to you that is called workforce development. So workforce deployment is for the core HR setup, and workforce development is the talent management or performance management setup. But these two offerings have a lot of common features in it, because if you do a talent management project, you have to basically do the core HR setup first and then go for talent management. And there are other offerings as well, like the payroll or the financials. It depends on what your client is licensed to. You will be able to access those features. Now, if you go to the workforce deployment, it will also highlight at the bottom about the content guide, the features, the setup task list, and related business object, everything in here. So you can download them in the form of PDF or Excel and then start your configuration. Now, this is the main reason where the Fusion differs from the EBs, because the setup and everything is here so methodically arranged by Oracle. So setup tasks and list, if you follow this, I mean, if you need to know your requirement first, that what you need to do in the system. After that, it is just a step-by-step activity. So that is why that is why it actually differs from EBs, because we do not have something like a proper requirement gathering document or gap fit document here, because in Fusion there is no customization allowed. And once you know the requirement, you go straight into the system, because what you have to do is actually there in the system in proper steps. You don't need to do any customization or any design build document there. So the requirement and the mapping is kind of straightforward. What you need to understand is what all things are possible from the client's point, and then you can straight away go to the system and start configuration. Now, I'll go back to the training agenda. Now, I have covered this part, the application overview and the training overview. Now, the first thing that comes over here is define geographies. Now, even before you start doing your configuration in the system, you have to define the geographies. Now, since we work most of our projects are in the Middle East, define geographies doesn't play an important role over here. But if you are doing a project in US or in Australia or in England, it is important that you do this define geographies. Now, until this part, we actually did all the viewing or navigation from the account holder's login. So all these are possible using the login that Oracle gives. You have to create your own user, but you can do it at a later point of time. But remember that the implementation user that Oracle gives is not an employee. So if you are going for a talent management or a performance management project, you necessarily need to create a super user in the system who is actually an employee. So the best practice, what we do is when we meet the client, we get to know all their key users, who are the business users of the system, who are actually going to use the system. We take all the details, the name and everything of those key users, and we create them as super users in the system who are actually an employee as well. Because most of the time, mainly in talent management, you cannot do any setup if you do from the implementation user, because the system expects the user to be an employee in order to do the setup for the talent management. So it's important that instead of using the implementation user or the so-called FCM user, you create your client's users in the system and do all the setups with them. Because many a time, a lot of setups doesn't work from FCM users login, but it works from the users login or the people's login. So it's better that we do things in the real time way from the day one. Now, for talking about geographies, I will give you an idea about what is meant by the geography. Now, I have created, let me just put it in a slideshow. Okay, so I've created this slide for having an understanding of what is a geography and how we should set up a geography. Now, when you go for implementation, you must be knowing on the day one that which all countries you are going to implement. So the country comes at the top in the geography hierarchy, and under that there is a geography structure, geography hierarchy, and the geography validation. Geography structure means what all elements are there in your address. The address could be the employee's address, the address could be your organization address, or if you are using any other module, there are a lot of places where the address is used for. So this address, if you are familiar with Oracle HCM or country extensions or country features, you must be knowing that every country has a different form of address. So this geography structure contains the elements of the address. Now, if you see under geography structure, I have given some examples like city, state, province. It could go on. So if you remember India address, there are things like street number, block number, house number, pin code, like that. If you think about UAE address, there is post box number, there is address line one, things like that. And if you go to US address, that is like city, county, zip code. So this geography structure holds all these names like city, state, province. It could have county, it could have pin code, zip code, like that. So when you create the geography structure, you can create these elements. So under structure, all these elements come into picture. Now, if you are doing a multi-country implementation, you have to create geography structure for each of those countries. Next comes the hierarchy. Now, the hierarchy defines that which all part of the structure should be a superset and which also should be a subset. So if you think about the US address structure, there is like state, city, and county. So state is the top level of the hierarchy, and then comes the city, and then county, then maybe the zip code. So the green box, if you are seeing, that is like a superset. So city comes inside the state, and then county comes inside the city. So you have to create this kind of a hierarchy in the system so that when the employees try to enter the address, they have to first select the state in which they belong, then it will populate the drop down of the cities inside the state. So the main purpose of having the geography structure in the system is that you are not allowed to enter any junk data for address in the system. And next one is the geography validation. So by using a validation, you are forcing this hierarchy in the system so that nobody is able to enter any arbitrary address in the system. Now, there are two ways of doing it. First of all, if we do Middle East implementation, then the address is basically a flat structure. It's not a hierarchy. So if you have already done implementation in Fusion, you know, it's like a address line one, then post box, then a city, that's all. So there is no, basically no hierarchy, and each of these fields are like it can contain any value, so there is no validation. In Middle East, we don't really go for a geography structure, but if you are implementing in any other country like England or Australia or America, then you have to go for a geography structure validation, because each of the address, let it be the employee address or a company address, has to be in a particular state, city, county, and a zip code or a postcode. So what they do is mainly in US, all the companies who implement Oracle, let it be EBS or Fusion, they go for a vendor, which is a renowned vendor is Vertex. They go for that vendor who has all the codes of these of the addresses of the entire country. So they do an interfacing with that third party and then get all their address codes in the system and run this geography loader. So what the loader does, it creates automatically this structure. So you need to put this structure in the system and then load the data from the third party and then put a geography validation in the system so that all the address or all the valid addresses of the country are already in the system. Now, when you load the employees, only those who have a valid address will get loaded in the system. So this is a mandatory step that you need to do for certain clients or certain countries. So far in any of the Middle East countries, we have not done it because in Middle East, the address structure is almost flat. There is no such state, city, country demarcation because it's not that, I mean, it's not that rigid over there. So the address structure in the Middle East is mostly like PO box, which is mandatory, and then the address line one and the city. So there is no such, and I am not aware that there is any such vendor available who has this kind of data. So if in those countries, you do not have a scope of doing geography validation. Now, I'll just go back to the system to show how it looks like the geography validation. Now, if you go to the offerings and then click on the setup, it will give you all the list of tasks that you need to complete for deploying or doing all the setup related tasks of the module. If you go to the enterprise profile and then manage geographies. Now, if you see all the previous tasks like load geographies for US, India, Canada, or run geography loader, this task will actually help you to do load the geographies from the third party. So if you have a third party which has got all the address details of this particular country, you can load it from the, it's like a flat file, you can load it from their data and then run the geography loader to create the proper hierarchy. Now, if you go to manage geography, here you have the option to create the address structures. Now, you have to search by the country code or the country name. This country code or country name follow the ISO structure of the country. So I have created an example for you to understand for the United Kingdom. Now, if you see this thing, when you search for the country, there are five options that come. One is geocoding defined, then address cleansing defined, structure, hierarchy, and validation. Now, geocoding is another feature that Oracle gives. Geocoding means when you define a location, the system understands the latitude and longitude of that particular place and it pops up automatically in the system. Now, this is not important from HR point of view, but if you are implementing Oracle Sales or Oracle Mobile Sales application, this is extremely important because the salespeople who use the application on the phone, they can actually understand how many contacts or how many prospects are there. In that same area as they belong. So if you make geocoding defined, if you just click this option here, after that you need to run a process called generate geocodes, which will enable it in the system. So when you get the instance, the geocoding is switched off. To enable it, you need to run a process. Also, this is more important when you do a sales implementation rather than an HR implementation. Now, if you go to the structures, okay. Now, when you first open this particular form, this will be blank. What I have done is I have created two geography types for England. One is county and another is post town. So similarly, you can create create a geography type, or you can use any of this geography type like city, postal code, province and state. If you're doing an implementation in Spain, province is important because it's a part of their address structure. So you can create your own address structures, or you can use the one given by Oracle. So I've created two new structures. Next is, after creating the structure, I need to define the hierarchy. So this is the hierarchy. Now in the hierarchy, you need to give exactly the particular county or the post town that are there in the entire country. So if you see from the top, there is a country, there is a county, and there is a post town. Like under United Kingdom, there is Berkshire, there is Reading, and that is how you need to structure the entire country's probable addresses. As an implementer is, or as a client, it's not possible to know all the address. So mostly you get it from a third party vendor who does the address validation. So in just in this way, you need to create all the samples of address, all the counties, all the post towns for that particular country for which you are doing the implementation. And the next stage after defining the hierarchy is to define the validation. Now, the validation is, it has got two parts. One is to enable the list of values, and another is to define the validation control. Now, I have enabled this list of values for the county and the post town, but at the moment I have defined only one mapping. If you remember the last one that I showed in the hierarchy, I have defined only Berkshire and Reading. So if somebody goes to enter the address, they will get only those two list of values in the county and the post town. And then you can have two validation control. One is error, another is no validation. Now, if you put an error validation control, then nobody will be able to enter address other than that is specified in the dropdown. And if you put no validation, then the list of values will be there, but still you can enter your own address. Now, the good part of this is that you're forcing a validation in the system that people should be allowed to use only the valid address or the valid dropdowns of city, country in the address fields. But if you put no validation, or rather if you put error validation, then you're actually stopping the junk data to be entered to the system. So most of the time when we go for implementation, the address values are not valid. There are a lot of chunks. So if you put an error validation, those addresses which doesn't have a valid address values, they will be stopped from, I mean, they will fail for from creating the employees in the system. So if you do this part and if you still don't have all the list of values, then you should put no validation in the validation control level. I just got a question, what is tax validation? Let me go back to the screen. So tax validation is for the country and the post town. If you see the geography type, in the US, you have different taxes for different states. So different in one geography type, you have different tax validations. So if you include tax validation and as well you are implementing payroll or fusion payroll, then the seeded tax validations of Oracle for the Oracle payroll will come into picture. So if you enable tax validation, then if you have proper validated cities and counties in the system, loaded in the system, then Oracle payroll will pick them up and apply the tax validation. But as I stated earlier, this is only applicable if you have proper data in the system. I mean, if you have taken the address structures from a valid vendor. Now, I've completed the defined geography, so I've talked about geography model and the structure. And the file-based import process is actually when you get the data from the third party and load it in the system. So it's just a normal file-based import process, which is available in this implementation task. I'm not going into the details because many a time we will not be doing this as a part of implementation. Now, next is define enterprise structure. Now, before we go into the enterprise structure, we need to understand the component of the enterprise and how we should do our mapping from the client requirements. Now, I believe many of you have a background from EBS. So I'm just opening one document, which I made this document after a few projects in Transys Infusion. From my experience with different clients. So in Fusion, when you talk about enterprise structure, enterprise is also known as the ultimate holding company. So when you go for an implementation, you know for which ultimate holding company you are doing the implementation. So if we talk about a particular, let's say we talk about ENBD or we talk about Mashrek, we talk about CBD, we know what is the name of the ultimate holding company. So in one instance, only one ultimate holding company is allowed, which we call as enterprise. And then below the enterprise, we create the other entities. Now, if you see in this document, in the fusion entities on the extreme left-hand side, I have listed the fusion entities. In fusion, below the enterprise, we can have only these three different types of entities. Rather than entity, we call it entity types. There are legal entity, business unit, and department. Now, if you have come from an EBS background, you can understand in EBS, the naming convention is different, but more or less the purpose of the entities are the same. So if we are going for a project where there is already an EBS setup and we are doing a coexistence, like we are implementing Fusion as well with an interfacing to EBS, we need to understand the mapping, because there the client will not give us the mapping. The mapping is already available because they are already using the EBS system. So this document will give you an idea about how to map the Fusion entities with the EBS entities. Also, if you are going for a fresh fusion implementation, then how to understand the client's organization structure to get what is a legal entity, what is a business unit, and what is a department. Now, most of the time, the legal entities are companies which is authorized for hiring people or issuing offer letter. Now, if you have a client which has got business in multiple countries, then mandatorily for each country, you need to create one legal entity. If you try to compare this thing with the EBS, then in EBS, the legal entity is like it maps with the business group. But due to a lot of restrictions in EBS, like even though we have a different business in a different country, we didn't used to create a different business group because a new business group means a lot of maintenance in the EBS. So we used to create only one business group and then handle the rest of the functionalities with customizations. So it will not be a straight one. It may not be a straight one-to-one mapping with the EBS business group. So here, again, you need to understand the client's business and how many legal entities you need to create will come up as a part of that understanding. So the legal entity, the rule of thumb is that if you were doing a mapping with EBS, whatever is created as a business group, create as a legal entity in Fusion as well. Try to understand how many legally authorized companies they have for hiring employees or issuing offer letters, because most of the time the client has got subsidiary company which they acquire, and they keep on using the same name in the offer letter. I mean the name of the subsidiary in the offer letter. Here you need to take the concurrence of the client that if that subsidiary needs to be created as a separate legal entity or they should operate under the name of the main legal entity. And another thing is that there is no such linking of the entities, I mean all these entities. in a hierarchical structure. But what we understand is the enterprise or the holding company is at the top, and legal entity, business unit, and departments comes below that. Now, there is a logical mapping. I will come to that later when we talk about the employee data. Now, next is the business unit. Now, business unit actually comes from the business functions of the client. Now, business function is that what all different areas the client operates. So if you talk about a company like a company which does a food production in 5 different countries, and they have a security unit, they have an IT unit, they have an administration unit, and they have a food production unit in each of these 5 countries. So what kind of work they do, that actually determines the business unit, how many business units they are going to have. It is also advice that you try to understand the area of operation or the business function of the client and put it in a diagram and then get the name of the business unit. So this is one way of deriving the business unit. Another thing is, if you really don't have multiple areas of operation, your client operates in only one area, then you have another way of deriving the business units is looking at the security point of view. Now, business unit is one way of doing data segregation in your client. So when we go into further details about business unit, we will come to know how business unit is linked to security, or rather data security. So if you say that the client has got operation in 5 different countries and each country has got a different HR, so then mandatorily you need to create 5 different business units for 5 different countries. So the mapping of business unit is a bit tricky. Legal entity is straightforward. Department, I will come to that, that is also straightforward. But the business unit is like you need to go to the deep understanding of how the business functions operate, how many business functions they have, as well how they want the security of the data to be. So these two things together derives the number of business units in the client. After I finish this document, I'll go to the PPT where you get a better idea of with an example as well. Now, if you try to compare this with the EBs, then most of the time they do it with the operating unit in EBs. So whatever you call as an operating unit in EBs comes as a business unit is in Fusion. But also you need to consider the security feature of this, because in EBs we have security profile and we have operating unit security. Those things you can use to derive the business unit in Fusion. Next is the department. Department is actually very easy to define, I mean much easier than business unit, because the moment you know where they define the cost center of the company, that is a department. So and EBs, in EBs, this is like the organized, because in EBs, everything is an organization. You define the type of organization, whether it is a department or it is a business group or it is like something else. So EBs, there is a different way of doing this. But in Fusion, you have this mandatory segregation, like legal entity, business unit, and department. And keep in mind that legal entity and business unit are mandatory for an employee to be created. So even before or going into the, putting your hands into the system, you have to get this thing clear with the client that how many legal entities and how many business units they want. Legal entity is very much important, because in Fusion, once you put an employee into a legal entity, you cannot change that. The only way you can change the legal entity of an employee is by doing a global transfer or by terminating and recreating him in another legal entity. So the basic structure has to be correct in the first place. The basic organization hierarchy has to be correct even before we think about data migration or creating employees in the system. Because a business unit, once created, you can change it. Department, once created, you can change it in the data. But once you have created a legal entity with a particular country and then attached it to an employee, you cannot change it. Other than then you have to again go for an entire remigration of the data. Now, in EBs, if you remember, we had something called a hierarchy diagrammer where we can put the business group, and below that all the organization as a hierarchy. But those kind of hierarchy doesn't exist in Fusion. So, but more, almost all the companies, almost 99% of the companies will have the hierarchy. They will have like one company at the top, and below that they will have departments or units or subunits like that. So the only way we can have that kind of a diagram in EVs, in Fusion, is through custom reporting. Because an employee will be attached to a proper legal entity, a business unit, and the department from where we can derive the hierarchy. So far the solution that we have given to the clients is that we use this flat structure of legal entity, business unit, and department, and then we create BI reports to get that particular hierarchy. So an employee has to be attached to a proper legal entity, proper business unit, and proper department, so that the hierarchy comes out of the employee data. So that is where big difference between the EVs and the Fusion structure, because if the client is using EVs, then he will have a pre mindset that in the Fusion also somewhere they have to put that hierarchy, that diagram. They will ask that where can we see that particular diagram in Fusion. So the answer is, if we sense that the client has an aspiration of seeing that diagram in the system, we have to be we have to have in the system the BI report design before we go for a CRP with the client. Let me know if you have any question up to this. Otherwise, I'll go to the example of org structure. I just got a question. If no employees are available in the organization, will be available in the org structure? Yes, surely it will be available. It depends on how we design our custom report in the system. So if the custom report, we put the condition that pull the organization, even if no employees are assigned, it will come in the structure.
Hi, Dargi.
Yeah.
Leave apart the organization diagram, is there any report at least that gives the dependency of the organizations, the list of organizations?
No, there is no such report which gives the this list of organization. There is one thing available which is called or enterprise structure configurator. I'll just go to this configurator after this and explain the details. It is not a hierarchy, because there is basically no hierarchy between a legal entity, business unit, and department. But what it does is, it when you create these things in the system, and these entities in the system, and you want to show it to the client for their sign off, it actually shows you, I mean, it's a report, it's a PDF report, it shows you the things in the form of a diagram. But I don't have that report with me in the system, from this system, because we don't use the configurator anymore. I will come to this point. We'll have a detailed discussion of what are the good and bad parts about using and not using the configurator for creating this enterprise structure. Then maybe we'll have a proper answer to your question. But as of seeded, there is no such report available. We need to create a report out of BI. Okay. Now, let me go back to the PowerPoint. Okay. So this is the structure that I created for an understanding of how this legal entity, business unit, and business function fall together. If you see at the top, there is enterprise. Enterprise could be only one. When we get the instance, the enterprise is already there in the system, which is called setup enterprise. If we want, we can change the name of the enterprise with our client's ultimate holding company. Now, below the enterprise, there is something called division. We didn't speak about division as a part of enterprise structure, because we don't use division in HR. Divisions are used more in finance. Now, let us forget that what we saw in the system. Let's think about this one. Now, logically, the division is actually the different ways or the different operation area of operations the client have, which you think about is more or less relates to your business unit. Now, this particular client has a division of security and food production. There could be multiple divisions, multiple area of operations like administration and field security. All these stuffs could be there. So let us consider that this client has security division in two countries and food production in another two countries. So altogether, there are four different countries in which they operate. So mandatorily, you need to create one legal entity for each country. Now, if they have a bit complicated scenario that in UAE, they have got two more subsidiary company which they have acquired, then you may or may not need to create two more legal entities in the UAE. But that is subject to discussion and approval from the client. Now, if we come one level further down, then there is something called business functions. So in these two countries, if we say that there is a sales and marketing business function as well, then as well the sales function is under the Kuwait legal entity, and this UAE legal entity does sales and marketing both. And if you go to Oman, then they do only sales, and then Saudi Arabia, they do sales and marketing both. So it is like these are the business functions. Now this helps us to decide how we should, I mean, how many business unit we should create. So there is no hard and fast rule, but as a best practice and as well what Oracle suggests is the business functions name, sorry, the business unit's name should be a combination of business function and the country name. So in this scenario, what could be the best possible unit name is you have legal entity UAE, legal entity Kuwait, and then you can create sales UAE, marketing UAE, sales Kuwait, sales Oman, sales Saudi Arabia, and sales marketing. So this could be your probable business unit name. So what you need to specifically do is to understand under each country how many functions they operate for, and then create your business unit from that. So this is kind of an implementation where you do not have an EBS, I mean they do not have a proper Oracle legacy system, and you are giving them the solution on the first place to create this. Now this solution will not definitely not work where you have a EBS system and you are doing a interface with them with Fusion, because then you have to also consider all the different types of department or the organization they have already created into EBS, and then put them back into the Fusion. Now, if you remember EBS, then in EBS, since you have an option to create different type of organization, like organization of type business unit, type departments, type unit, subunit, everything. So whenever you go to such a client where they have an EBS, there will definitely be a lot of different type of organization. Not necessarily we can migrate everything into Fusion, because in Fusion you can see only legal entity, business unit, and department. These are the three things you can actually put in the employee level. So you may need to discard a lot of organization from the EBS because they are not needed to be in the Fusion. In Fusion, only these three things are important, which comes into the employee level. So it's also like it's also like a data collection issue that we should suggest it to the client that which one are important, because in EBS, since we have a diagrammer and the proper hierarchy, a way of defining hierarchy in the system, the client do a lot of organizations, they create a lot of organizations with different type, because they can see the diagrammer and they can understand how the different units or subunits fall in their entire enterprise. They cannot do the same thing in Fusion. So Fusion, or when we migrate the data into the Fusion, it already becomes limited of what all units or what all different type of entities we can migrate. So before we go to meet the client, we have an option to see their website and get an idea about what all business functions they operate, what all countries they have business in, and what could be the probable name. So when we do the first demo, or when we do the CRP one, or even before we meet the client, if we study their web page, we come to know a lot of things about their organization structure, and we can set it up in the system so that they also can get an idea about how the fusion system works in terms of entities, legal entity, business unit, and departments. Departments I didn't put in this slide because the department is pretty easy to identify. It's the cost centers. So if you have any more questions on this, please let me know. Otherwise, I'll go back to the system to see the details of how this structure can be put in the system. Okay, so there are two ways of putting this structure in the system. There is something called Enterprise Structure Configurator, which Oracle gives. It's a tool, it's kind of a wizard where it's a step-by-step question. They will ask what is the name of your enterprise, what is the name of your division you want to put, and then what legal entity, which country you want to put. It's very nice. You can start putting the names, and when you click save, all at once it will generate your whole enterprise structure with the names and the proper countries. It will create the countries and legislation. I got a question, are cost centers only specific to departments? Cost centers are not specific only to departments. You need to understand the payroll structure a bit to understand how the cost centers fall in the ERP. Now, you can define cost centers at various levels, but in the enterprise structure, you can define cost centers only in the department level. So cost centers you can create at payroll level, you can create at employee level, and you can create element level, entries level, and you can create on the department employee level as well and the department level. But in the enterprise structure, you can create only in the department level. So if many a time we find that they are calling something as unit, I mean in the EBs they are calling something as unit, but they have a cost center defined there. So the moment we see the cost center, we know it cannot be a business unit. It has to be a department. So the naming convention and all may be different in EBs, because in EBs it's more flexible since you call everything as an organization. So creation of cost center is easy over there. You can create cost center in any different type. We can definitely add employees to business unit, but department is also a part of employee data where it holds the cost center. So when we create an employee, on the legal entity and business unit are mandatory by Oracle. We can make department also mandatory using the screen personalization. Okay, so I'm going back to the system now, how to put this structure, enterprise structure in the system. Now there is something called Enterprise Structure Configurator, which is a tool that helps you to put this data, this enterprise data in the system. So if you have the list of legal entity, list of business unit, and list of departments from the client, you can put it in the configurator, run the configurator. Now when you run the configurator, at the output of the configurator, you get the structure like legal entity, business unit, and department of the client. It comes really nice with the like proper logical grouping. Like it shows the enterprise at the top, and then it shows the business unit, and then the legal entity, departments, locations as well it shows. But the problem with the configurator is that the reason we have never used the configurator in any of the projects that I know, because when they first launched a configurator in release 5, it had a bug and it didn't work. So even in release 7, release 8, it never worked. So we never went for the configurator. But the good part about the configurator is it generates the PDF. Now, I do not have the sample copy of the PDF with me. If somebody really wants, I can search for it somewhere else and give it to you just to show how it looks like. Because most of the time when we put the entities in the system, we need to show the client for their sign off or for their approval that this is the structure that we have created in the system. We can create a structure ourselves by pulling out a report, but the system does it really nice way, and it comes with the Oracle logo on the top. that what all the configurator has created. And if the client is not happy with the configuration or the setup, or he wants to change the setup, then there is an option called rollback. We can roll back the entire configuration. Now, the problem with not using the configurator is if we create straight away legal entities, business unit, and organization or the departments in the system, then we have no option to roll them back. Just like any other work structures, you cannot delete a work structure, or you cannot delete an entity. You have to just deactivate, or you have to indent that. So that is one shortcoming of not using the configurator. But since the configurator never worked until a lot of releases of Oracle, so as a practice, we never use the configurator. Yeah, so this is the configurator, establish enterprise structures. It comes under enterprise profile and establish enterprise structures. Now this is the screen where from where you can run the configurator. You have to create a configurator here. You click on the plus sign, it will allow you to create a configurator. Now you can give a name for the configurator, like the name for the configurator should be the same name as the project. Now, once you give the name of the configurator, it will open up this kind of a page where you can give the enterprise name, the legal name of the enterprise, the identifier. And then if you see on the top, you will see all the train stops for creating your other enterprise entities like divisions, legal entities, business units, reference data set, and location set. So from this page, you can start and keep on creating all the details that you have already gathered from your client. But the bad part of this, until the last page, you don't know whether the configurator is going to work. So the last time when I used the configurator was release 7, I think, and it didn't work. It was a bug in Oracle. They were still working on it. And I'm not sure if in release 11, it is fixed now. So we never tried using it again because it's actually a waste of time. And what it does is, even if it doesn't do, and the last stage, it last step, it errors, it creates some backend objects in the system. So which you cannot delete. So there are a lot of side effects of using the configurator for which we stopped using the configurator. So I am actually not going into the configurator because this is a pre-configured instance where the enterprise and everything are configured. So if I try to use the configurator now, it will give me an error that the enterprise already exists and there could be only one enterprise in the system. So I'm not using this, but if you get a chance to use it in any of the projects, you may try your luck in this. The good part of using it is that you can do your entire configuration in a rollback mode where you don't commit it. You show it to the client, the PDF that it generates, very nice way of putting things together, putting the entire structure together. You can show it to the client, take their sign off, and if they're not happy, you have an option to roll back the entire setup. So this is a good part of it, of using this configurator. Now, if we assume that this thing doesn't work and we are doing the setup manually in the system, then we need to go through each of these tasks like manage legal entity, create business unit, create reference data set, and create locations and everything. And that. So let us assume that we don't have it and we'll go to the system of creating it one by one. You can see there is something called rollback configuration. This is where you actually, after creating a configuration, you can roll it back if you're not happy with your end result. Now, let me go back to the agenda again. Now, I've spoken about enterprise structure configuration, using enterprise structure configuration, and then establishing the job and position structure. Now, if we remember about EVs, the job and positions were structure were a bit different because you had an option to create the structure. So you could determine how you want your job to look like, how many segments you want in your job, how many segments you want in your position. Basically, they were all flex fields defined at the business group level. Now, Oracle has entirely done away with this segment thing or the flexible thing in Fusion. So here, position and job are more like a one field or a more like a flat structure. But the good part of it is that they have given a lot of attributes, what we call. So a job will have a job title, will have a job description, there could be a job profile. When we actually go into the structure, we will see there are a lot of stuff they have given, which is actually replacing our EVs flex fields concept. Because what we used to do in the flex field is that when we define a job, we used to define the first segment as a job code. The second segment will be job name. The third segment could be job description, fourth segment, and so on it goes. Now we don't need to think about, we don't need to worry about that. Because in EVs, we used to spend a lot of time in determining how many segments should ideally be there in the job. And we used to have a lot of meetings with the client, how they want it to look like. But here they have made it more clear that exactly what kind of attributes should be there in the jobs or the positions, and which is definitely from the best practices. So you can present, when you actually go to create the jobs, you can discuss it with the client, which all attributes they want, or they have the values, they can fill it, but there, or if they don't have, they can leave it blank. Okay, now I will go into the job and positions later. I will start with the first thing, that is the legal entity. Now, before creating the legal entity, you need to know the valid offices of the client. So you need to know the legal addresses. The legal addresses are country specific. So if you go to the manage legal addresses, here you can create the country specific legal addresses. There are already some addresses in the system. So this is how the address structure looks like. So you have to choose a country, and once you choose the country, it generates the address structure for the country. So if you change the country, automatically you get to see a new address structure. Now here, as you can see, since we have not defined any geography validation for UAE, there is no structure. It's a flat address. So you have to give address line 1, line 2, Emirate. That's all. So if we really have a proper validation given in the system, then you first need to select your Emirate that will actually generate which all PO boxes are valid in that particular Emirate, which all address line 2 is valid in that Emirate. Like that, it will come. This screen is a bit tricky because when you create the address, there is no save option here. So you need to put all the fields here, click on OK. And when you come out in the search screen, you have to give a save and close here. Most of the times we get into a trouble that we are creating the address, but it's not getting saved. The reason is that we are not clicking the save outside here. Okay, now after creating the legal addresses, you need to create the legal entity. Now another thing is that since data migration is a big part of any HR project, we don't create this, we create legal entity and business unit, but we don't create other structures like department, job and positions ourselves. We let it be let it get loaded through the FDL or HDL, whichever is used for the data migration. There is one more way of loading the data using the spreadsheet loader, but that is a much more primitive method. It's an easy way, but it's a much more primitive method of loading. We don't use that anymore. So whether you're using FDL or HDL, you need to get that particular format of the data of your enterprise in that loader. But legal entity you need to create in the system. I mean, that has to be manually, legal entity and business unit. Now, when you go to manage legal entity, it will ask you if you want to create a new legal entity, or if you already have created a legal entity, you can select that and do changes over there. We have already some legal entities created in the system. So this will show you the list of legal entities that has been created in the system. So these are the details that you need for creating the legal entity. You need the country. Country is actually important here because that is what specifies the legislation. You need to give a name of the legal entity and an identifier. There is a start and end date, but they are not mandatory. And as well, once a legal entity is created, you cannot delete it. You can just put an end date to it. And then you can mark the legal entity as a payroll statutory unit if you are using Oracle payroll as well, or Fusion payroll as well for this. Because once you do this, then only you can attach the tax cards or the social insurance card to the employees who belongs to this legal entity. And then if you remember the previous step where we created the legal address, you need to mandatorily attach a legal address to the legal entity. So in the legal address, you choose the country, and here while creating the legal entity, when you choose the country, it will show you all the valid legal addresses that you have created in the previous step. Now there is the next step called Manage Legal Entity Registration. This is not mandatory. This is just for reporting. You need to put registration details of the legal entity in the system. Most of the time the finance will have the information about the legal entity details, but most of the time we don't do this Manage Legal Entity Registration. We do legal address, legal entity, and then the next important step is to do the Manage Legal Entity HCM information. So now this page is very much important because this is actually where you put all the information which are important for hiring the employees. Now if you see, there are information like workday information, start time, end time, standard working hours, and working frequency. If you remember in EBs that when you create a business unit, you had to, business group, you had to give all this information. What is the standard working hours of the company? What is the working frequency? What is the start time and end time? So similarly here also, if you have to give all these details. When you create an employee who belongs to this particular legal entity, automatically this information will be attributed to the employee data. And you can as well override them. Now, there are legal employer information after the workday information. Yeah, I just got a question about the employment model. I'll come to that. Okay. The salary level, you can... Now, let me talk about the employment model first because that question came. Now, the employment model is mandatory to create a legal entity or to hire an employee to the legal entity. Now see, there are a lot of options here in the employment model, two-tier, three-tier, single contract, single assignment, multiple contract, multiple assignment, like that. Now, there are two reasons why this thing is important. One is that if you have employee who work in multiple projects or have multiple assignment in your enterprise, then you can add multiple assignment. I mean, you can choose any of these multiple assignment ones. And now there are another thing called two-tier or three-tier. Now, two-tier means there is only assignment, and three-tier means there is employment term and employment assignment. Now, the terms comes into picture only when if you have multiple legal employer associated at the same time. So if you see, I'll just open one more screen where it will allow you to see the employee screen as well. It's taking a bit long time to open. Now, let me explain it here. So if you have three-tier model chosen over here, then your employment screen will look different. It will have two tabs. Now, if you have two-tier, it will show only one tab, which is the assignment tab. So let me just open one employee. So if you see this section, now this is how an employee information looks like in Fusion. You have employment information and then you have assignment information. Now if you see this assignment details screen, there is only one tab called assignment details. This is because this is a two-tier model. Now if you have a three-tier model, then there will be two tabs. One is work terms and then assignment details. One work term may have multiple assignments. And then you have another work term which can have again multiple assignments. So if we really go into very complicated implementation where they want to capture project details as part of the employee assignment details, which is not advised definitely, because if you want to have projects, you should have ideally projects module implemented. So sometimes they want that in the employee assignment only they should capture different project information. There we need to go for multiple assignment model. And then again, if they have different legal employer or different subsidiary companies in which the employee works in different projects, so it may happen that the employee works for legal entity one in two projects, legal entity two in three projects, then you should have work terms and work assignment both. Then you have to go for any of these three-tier models. So in three-tier, you have multiple terms, multiple assignment, you have multiple term, single assignment, single term, multiple assignment, like this. I got a question if this can be changed. That is another discussion. I'll have this after I finish this. So as a best practice, what we do is we use this single contract and single assignment model. As a best practice for all the clients so far, we have used single contract and single assignment. The reason being that, first of all, we do not encourage to have employment terms at the employee's level, because if you want to capture project information, you better convince your client to have projects module in place. capturing multiple assignment also lead to different complications in the payroll system. So which we try to make it as simple as possible. Another thing is when you have this three-tier model implemented, the HR, the screen looks so complicated with multiple terms and multiple assignment. When the HR does an assignment change, that person really becomes clueless because there are so many things to change there, and you have to be very careful from which terms and which assignment you want to do the change. So whatever project I have done so far, I have used this single contract, single assignment, because contract is important. Contract is very much important in Middle East, because every client mandatorily goes for this fixed contract or unlimited contract. So you need to have this contract option given for the employee level. So we do this two-tier single contract, single assignment as a rule of thumb here. Okay, now about this changing. You can change this thing, this two-tier and three-tier thing, but there is a practical issue here. See this screen, there is only assignment details and it is a two-tier hierarchy, two-tier employment model. Now today, if I want to move to three-tier from two-tier, this is possible because, if you want to move from two-tier to three-tier, that is not possible, because you can understand that all of a sudden one new tab will start showing up in the system which will not have any value. So it doesn't allow. So today, if you have an enterprise which has got two-tier single assignment and if you want to move it to three-tier, that is not possible. But if you have a three-tier and if you want to move back to two-tier, that is possible, because from the system point of view, one tab just gets vanished. So we have done that because in the past, like very beginning in the release 5 projects, when we didn't have much idea about the best practices, we used to go for this three-tier, because sometimes Oracle recommends using three-tier, because this captures the, now if you have idea about the Middle East payroll, then there is something called the gratuity and the social security. Now gratuity actually depends on your fixed contract or unlimited contract, so they suggest that you go for a three-tier three-tier model, because you can capture the contract types for different companies in your terms. But what we do is even if we don't use three-tier, we can handle that in payroll. There are n number of ways to handle that in payroll. We can use this single contract, single assignment model, and then we can open up a DFF over here to capture the contract type in the other companies and use that DFF in the payroll formulas. As a best practice, that's why we don't use this three-tier employment model, because it becomes very much complicated. Your payroll formulas also becomes complicated because it generates endless number of database items for each of these terms and assignment. So the movement of employees from two-tier to three-tier is not possible, but movement from three-tier to two-tier is possible. We have done that in practical sense for two clients, because initially when we went with Oracle's recommendation, we gave this three-tier. That was very initial days, I think some 3 years back. But now we don't do it anymore. We do only two-tier single contract, single assignment, where you can capture the contract information as well, and you can have the single assignment information. And if you really need to have multiple assignment information, you can go for the two-tier multiple assignment model. It will also have a single tab over there. It will not be very much complicated, and you can have multiple assignment information. If you really want to have more than one project information stored at the employee level, you can go for two-tier multiple assignment. In that case, you need to have for the contract information, you need to have a DFF open at the employment level. And if nothing really works and you really, really have a desire to go for this three-tier employment model, then you can go for multiple terms and multiple assignment model. It will allow you to have multiple terms, and for each terms you can have multiple assignments, and for each assignment you can capture the contract type. So if you have a really complicated kind of a situation where your employee works in one legal employer for fixed contract, another legal employer for unlimited contract, and for each legal employer 2-3 different types of projects, then you can go for this 3-tier multiple employment terms and multiple assignment. I don't know why they don't give this, even until release 11, they didn't make this employment model mandatory at the legal employer level. Because without this, you cannot create employees in the system. Okay. Now, once you have decided this employment model, you can fill up this part of the legal employer information. There is a salary level available. You can put whether you want the salary level to be as a part of assignment or the terms. If you are using two-tier model, it has to be assignment by default. Now, then there is worker number generation. Please don't confuse this worker number with the person number. This is not the person number. We will come to person number generation method later part where we go for the enterprise details. So worker number is different from person number. Person number is a unique key of every person. Worker number is just a non-mandatory thing. Now let me tell you also how the person number relates to employee number in EBs. Now in EBs we used to have employee number and person ID. Employee number is something that was assigned to each and every employee. Employee, not the dependents. And person ID is something that was assigned to every employee as well as dependent at the backend. But in Fusion, there is nothing called employee number. There is a person number which is applied to everybody, all the employees as well as the dependents. There is a person ID, but that is at the backend. We cannot see that. So this is where you need to change your mindset from EBS to Fusion, because here even you can search the dependents using the employee number or the person number. And this worker number generation, worker number is a non-mandatory field that is given by Oracle for every employee. What happens is sometimes if you do a multi-country implementation or a multiple legal employer implementation, you have a business process that transfers the employees from one legal employer to another legal employer. Now, it may happen that in the new legal employer, you have a different person number compared to the previous one, but you want to store the previous number as well. So this is where you actually store the new worker number. This is not a mandatory field. And most importantly, this field is not unique. There is no validation on this field. So the person number is unique. You cannot have two employees with the same person number, but on this worker number field, this is not unique. So even two worker can have the same worker number and the system will not throw any error. Now that is where we need to be a bit careful while about the usage of this field, because many a time in Fusion, we have this limitation of person number. We cannot do a lot of things with the person number. In EBS, we had an option of writing fast formulas for generating person number. In Fusion, we don't have that. So most of the time we may feel that we can advise to the client to use worker number, but be very careful with this because this worker number doesn't have any validation. Here there is minimum and maximum retirement age. You can assign that if it is required by your company, and then the maximum age of a minor, like what is the minimum start age with the company. Sometimes you're not allowed to work if you are less than 18 years, so you can put it over here. And then there are two more fields, allow employment terms override as assignment and people group flex field structure. This people group flex field doesn't differ from what it used to be in the EBS. For even though they removed the flex field structure from the job and position, they kept it for the people group and costing. So you can configure the people group. Mostly we use it when we have payroll implemented. So I will go into the flex field details maybe in the later sessions. And then this part, allow employment terms override as assignment. This is important if you are using a three-tier assignment. So what it does is, when you have a three-tier assignment, then whatever you enter in the terms sometimes get copied in the assignment. So if you have a term where the employee works for legal employer A, business unit B, department, position, all these stuffs, when you enter those information, it gets copied in the assignment details. Now if you want, you can overwrite the assignment details as well. So if you have one term and multiple assignment, then definitely you need to change the assignment details for each of the project he works for. Then you have to set this option as yes, allow employment terms override at the assignment. But if you are going for a two-tier, you don't need to worry about this. Other than this part, there is one more thing called position synchronization. This position synchronization, they have started from release 11, I guess. Yes. So we'll talk about position synchronization in more details when we go to the position screen, but it has got something to do with the position defaults at the employee level. Okay. Now there is one more tab in the legal entity, that is payroll statutory unit. You can see there is something called AE legislative data group. This is important because this is what determines the country for which your legal entity is created. This country, it comes with the country short name AE, legislative data group. Now when you create the legal entity, automatically this data group comes into picture. It automatically comes over here. But if you want to change the data group name, because most of the time we want to give it the full name of the country, like United Arab Emirates, so we can do the change in the data group name at the back end. You have to go to the manage legislative data group task and change it. And also you can give the fiscal year started. This is not important, but this is for the reporting purpose. If you have any question, please let me know. Okay, now after this legal employer details, I'll go to the enterprise level. There are a few things that you need to set when you do the, when you start the implementation. Now if you go to the workforce structures, once you do the legal structures, you complete the information related to the legal entity, then you can go to organization structure to do the rest of the things like business units and departments, and workforce structures you can do the enterprise details. So if you open the manage enterprise HCM information task, now, as I said, that this enterprise is already created in the system. We just need to change the name if we want. It is called Setup Enterprise when it is first there. Okay. Now, whatever we saw at the legal entity level, like workday information, standard working hours, everything, we can set it at the enterprise level as well. But the thing is that then it will be applicable to all the legal entity. Most of the time, different legal entities, if they are created in different countries, they follow different work hours. So we can override that information at legal entity level as well. Now here, exactly the same information are there, like employment model, worker number generation, and salary level, whatever you saw there. in the legal entity are as well available at the enterprise, one extra thing is available, which is called person number generation method. So you can understand the person number generation method is unique for the entire enterprise or all the legal entity. There are two different types of person number generation method which we have here. One is automatic, another is manual. There is one formula option, but Oracle doesn't have any formula available for this as well. They don't have any enhancement for doing the formula. So we have to just forget about the formula option for the person number generation and concentrate on this automatic and manual numbering. Now, manual numbering is when you create the employees, you can give the number, person number, and automatically creating person number is you can set an initial number and then it will start taking the number from that. And if you do not have any initial number, it will start creating it from one. Now there are two options, automatic prior to submission and automatic upon final save. Now automatic prior to submission is that when you start creating the employees, it will generate the automatic number. I mean, if you remember, all those who have created employees in the system, when you first create it, generates the employee number, but it doesn't get saved in the system until you submit or until you submit the employee details. But if you do automatic upon final save, the moment you enter the first page in the employee information, it will get saved. So there are good thing and bad thing about it. If you create the employee, but if you are not sure until you submit the information, the employee number doesn't get saved in the system. So in that way, you save the sequence. So this is just a judgment that you want to use while choosing the automatic employee number generation method. But you need to keep this in mind. And when you go for implementation, you need to be sure about this. You need to convey this to your client importantly on the day one, that in Fusion the person number generation method is unique and it is for all the legal employer. It follows the same sequence as well. The sequence consists of dependents as well, because most of the time the clients have a legacy method of having different employee number sequence for different person type, different legal entity, and dependents doesn't fall on the same sequence as the employee. So this comes actually as a big surprise for them when they see that Fusion cannot cater to this. But this is a fact, and all the implementations have lived with this so far. So we need to let them understand this, because they may need to change their way of employee number generation depending on this. Most of the times the employee numbers get generated in a sequence. I got a question, personalization possible in the employee number? Sorry, I didn't get the question. Can you please be a bit elaborate? Okay, person number generation from automatic to manual. Yes, that is possible. That is very much possible. You can change the person number from automatic to manual. Just you have to be aware of the sequence. Anytime you can change it. I think EBs, it doesn't allow to change in both ways, but here it allows. Okay. So the points about person number generation is that all your employees, contractors, and dependents, everybody follows the same sequence of person number generation. So let us consider that we have gone live today and the last employee number is 500, and tomorrow I start hiring new people. 501 is the first employee, and if he has two dependents, they will be 502 and 503. And then the next employee will be 504. This is how it happens in Fusion, and the client needs to accept that, because 90% of the cases the client doesn't have any employee number for the dependents because they don't have. But what Oracle tells is that it's a best practice to identify dependents or your contractors not by employee number but by the person type. So that is how, I mean, that's how the best practice is, and you have to convey this to the client on the very first day, because it's not good that they come to know about it after your CRPs and everything is over and design is finalized, and then they come to know that they cannot use different number sequence for different employee type. Another thing is, if your client is comfortable having manual person number generation, you can suggest that to them, but it is a huge maintenance because most of the time nobody will remember the last employee number. And another thing is, even if you give person number generation as manual, you cannot control the dependent number generation. That will be automatic. So every time, even if you give manual person number generation, somebody has to pull out a report to see what is the last employee number generated with the dependent number generation. I just got a question if we can have a prefix. Yes, we can have a prefix, but not with the automatic. So automatic is the number, only number is possible. Also, if you have the previous, since we are dealing with this from very long time with every client, so a lot of the clients wanted this formula, person number generation method. So there were a lot of enhancements raised, but Oracle has rejected all the enhancements and there is no plan for future enhancement request. Like, there is no plan to deploy those enhancements in the future. So what they believe is that the best practice is to have the person number generation as automatic, to have the same sequence for all your person types and dependents, and the best way to identify your workforce is by the person type, not by the person number. So almost all the clients I have seen in the legacy, what they do is they have a series. So if they say that we have employees in Kuwait, they fall in the 7 series. Our contractors fall in the 6 series. Employees fall in the 1 series. So this is how it, all the multinational companies do. But if they're adapting to cloud, they have to come out of this process and they have to have only one sequence for all the person types. Using manual person numbering method doesn't really work because we have tried to give it to a few clients. They went to manual, but then they had to change it to automatic because it's a huge maintenance and it actually makes their work difficult. So only one way out is to use the automatic person number generation. And all your legal entities will follow the same person number sequence. And if you really want to give a separate identifier to your employees from different legal entities, then you can use the worker number. I can give you one example. Suppose your client has different person number for different legal entities, different person number sequence. And when they move into Fusion, after seeing all these details, they want to switch to automatic number generation. But still, they want to keep that old person number for different sequence in a different new field. So you can suggest them to put that in the worker number field. Worker number, actually you can have for different legal entities, you can have different numbers, but the problem there is that is not a unique thing. So the system will not check if you are using same number for two different legal entities for two workers. And Oracle kind of strongly discourages the usage of worker number for as a replacement of the employee number in EBs. So you should actually use person number and worker number in case if you want to add the extra information while migrating, or if you want the old or the new person number to be stored when they transfer the legal entities. Now, there is currency support information. This is this comes into picture when you have your payroll and finance implemented. Then currency conversion information you can store here. Then this part is important, user and role provisioning information. If you have any question, anybody about the person number and all, you can let me know. Okay, so user and role provisioning method, we will see in details about the role creation and how role creation differs from EBs into Fusion. Now, what is important here is this end username and password. Now, you have this option that when you create an employee, if you give a proper email address, a valid email address to the employee, at the moment you create, you can send the username and password to that email address so that the employee can immediately log into the account. But as a best practice, we set it as no while we create the while we do our implementation, because every company has got a policy of letting the password to be known to the employees. So we don't do it this way. We migrate the information and then the client IT or the security team decides how to let the employees know the username and the password. And another thing is important here, this default username format. Now, in EBs, what used to happen is that we create the employee and then we create the users, and then there we can choose the username. But here what happens is the moment you create the employee, automatically the user account gets created. So this is where you can choose how you want your username to look like. There are options like it could be the person number, it could be the primary work email if you have entered a valid work email, and there is something defined by Oracle Identity Management. Now, defined by Oracle Identity Management means that by default it will be your first name dot last name at oracle.com. Now, a lot of companies have got this policy that your username will be first name dot last name at the company's domain. So if your scenario is that simple, then you can raise an SR with Oracle to tell them to change the domain from Oracle to your client's domain. That will solve this issue. But most of the time what we do is, if your username is like something very different, which is not a part of all these three or four options, if it is not email, if it is not domain, or if it's not person number, then we set it as defined by Oracle Identity Management, and then we migrate the information separately. We update the username from the identity management to whatever is the client's username, because if your client's username is like your initials at the rate clientdomain.com, then you cannot do it here. And if you are doing a data migration, or if you're migrating the data of the employees, then there you can specify what you want your username to be. But for your regular day-to-day activities like daily employee creation and letting the username known, you need to train them that once the employee is created, you have to go specifically to the identity management and change the username before you let them know the username and password. And then there are a few more things at the enterprise level: global payroll element information to archive US balance information. You will get to know about this when you do the payroll training. I got a question: can we set the username only with the first and the last? That is possible if you are using first and the first dot last at the rate your company domain, otherwise not. Then, you cannot set it from here. You have to do it specifically from the identity management. Now, there is a position synchronization information available over here. Now, if you do not have any more questions over here, I will move into the job and position details. Okay. So after you have completed your enterprise legal employer, and next thing you need to do is your business units. The business units are configured from the manage business unit tasks. Now there is not much information about the business unit to be captured here, but what is really important is the default set. So you give the details of the business unit, like the name of the business unit. If you want to give the location of the business unit, you can add here. Business unit manager. Manager is important because most of the time the business functions of each country are handled by a single person. So if you have that kind of a requirement from your client to capture the business function manager of each country, you can put the manager name here. It basically shows the all the employees of your company in this drop-down. Now for the default set, this is important here because this is what determines the security feature of the business unit. Now, if you remember on the discussion when we were having about the business unit, how to choose what should be your name of the business unit, how many business units should have, one of the points were like how many security, like how different ways you should have a data security in the system. So if we consider a simple scenario, like your business unit data is actually segregated by the number of countries that you have, then we need to create reference data set for each of those countries. So let me cancel this and create a new business unit. Okay, so here you can see there is business unit name, and in the default set you have a drop down where you can choose from. Now there is a common set and there are a lot of other reference data set. Reference data set you can create and you can give the name of your choice. Now the common set helps to have this business unit data all across your enterprise. So sometimes we say that we have a requirement that this particular grade should be applicable to employees hired in this legal entity only. So the way that we can restrict it is that by not using a common set, but we can use a particular reference data set. With common set, the data becomes common all across. So you cannot really apply a security over there. So before creating a business unit, you need to create a reference data set. Now the name of the reference data sets are like as per your choice. So mostly we create a reference data set for each of the data that we need to secure. If it is by country, then you can create reference data set with each country name. If it is by legal employer, then you can create reference data set by the legal employer name. So once you create the reference data set, that will come over here and you can choose each of them for creating your business unit. The way you find all these tasks is very easy. Like here they have given it with different functional areas, and you click on the functional areas and you see all the tasks. But even if you don't find the task over here, you can go to search task and then give the task name and it will show up in your particular area. Now, once you have completed your legal entity business unit, the next thing is you need to create your departments. Now, department, grade, and location, these three things you can actually secure using the reference data set. So if you go to manage departments, you can create a department and you can choose which reference data set it belongs to, whether it's a common set or it's a particular reference data set. You can give name, and just like any other workforce entities, once a department is created, you cannot delete it unless you create it using a configurator. And if it's not no longer in use, you can set the status as inactive. It is important to, if a department is in use and then you want to end date it, instead of making it inactive, you can put a effective end date to the department, because the history of the employee assignment holds the department data. So you should make it inactive until a particular date. Otherwise, all those employee history information will become invalid. You can give a location to the department if you want, and there is attachment option in any of these workforce structures like department and grade and everything. Now, it could serve a purpose, like if you have an approval from the finance for creating the department, you can add it in the attachment. It allows any kind of document. One more thing, let me explain this as well. Now, when I show you the department grade and location creation as well in legal entity, there is something called action reason. Now, what happens in Fusion, each and every actions that you do, let it be on employee data or on org structured data, this is audited. Audited in the sense you have a chance to make it audited. So if you change employee data, there has to be a reason for that. So in EBS, it was not like that. EBS never really asked for a reason for data change, but in Fusion, you can capture the each and every reason of data change. And the good thing is that you can configure all these reasons. So the reason for creating a department, when we create a new department, there has to be a reason, like a new office has opened or a previous office has been renamed, something like that. So you can actually choose the action reason here. At the moment, there is nothing configured in the action reason lookup, but we can configure it. And we can give the name of our choice for each of the lookups. So if you change any department data or you create a new department, you can choose the action reason accordingly. So this is nothing but the purpose of this is reporting and also to get everything audited. So why you are creating a new department, why you are changing an employee data. Employee data action reason is mandatory, because without a reason, you cannot change an employee data. So if you're changing an employee data, either it's a correction or it's a transfer of the employee or it's a promotion of the employee or if it's an assignment change of the employee. So if you want your client's data to be really audited, you can suggest them this action reason field. Now the next information, the next page is about the department details. You can put department manager name over here. You can choose the manager name. This is where you actually put the cost center information of the department. And now when you go to the payroll training, there you will learn how to create a cost center and how to map the cost center to the department. Now department also has got workday information like standard working hours and work start time and end time. Now you can understand that all this information you can as well enter at the enterprise level, at the legal employer level, and as well as the department level. Also, you can override these things at the employee level. So employee actually inherits all this information. So if you define something at the legal employer level and create an employee in the legal employer, then he inherits all this work hours information from the legal employer. Similarly, at the position level also, you can define all this information and employee can inherit all this. And if you want to override, you can do it at the employee level. And there are certain country specific information for the department which you can use if you are actually implementing in that legislation. Another thing that is a best practice we follow is that this cost center information, I mean, all the companies use department to hold their cost center information, but you cannot configure this particular way of cost centers if you do not have payroll implemented or if you do not have your chart of accounts implemented. So many a time, if we don't have a payroll module implementation, but we are only going for the HR, then the client really wants to hold the cost center information in the department level. What we recommend them is that open a flex field or open a custom field in this form and hold the cost center information. So in EBs, it's quite easy to do all those setups of cost center and payroll information, but in Fusion, it's very difficult. You really need to have a proper chart of account configured by someone in the finance module to move ahead with this task. So most of the time, the client doesn't have the license of finance, or the client has no intention to implement finance or payroll, but they still want to capture the cost center information. So then in that case, we cannot use this part, this GL cost center, but we can still open a flex field or a custom field anywhere here and hold the cost center information. So once this all is created, we can review and submit the information. The department will get created in the system. Now, all this creation of the departments and grade, everything can be approval driven. So when we discuss about the approvals, we will see how to create the approvals, because if the HR is creating the departments, they may want the department approval to go to somebody in the finance. So in that way, they can reduce a lot of paperwork for approval in the system. Now, after departments, you can do the location. Now, this is just for, I'm showing you in the system how to create this from the front end. But when you go for an implementation, all this task needs to be done by the FBL or the HTL as a mass data load. Now for the locations, now locations are also a bit tricky to create, because once you create a location, it will ask you for the country name. And this location country, if you have not created it with the right information in the first place, you cannot change it later. Locations are also set specific, so you can have common set or have any other reference data set for creating the location. And then there is action reason. I can give you an example. When I was working with this shelf drilling implementation, they are actually a shallow water drilling company, so that they have rigs and they keep on moving the rigs all across the world. So they had a typical requirement of the location name, because the problem is today you have a rig in one country like Thailand, and tomorrow you're moving the rig to Singapore. Now you cannot change the location country there, and you cannot create a new location, because actually that is historically attached to a lot of employees. So there is something called a secondary location name that Oracle has given in this Fusion only. So if you are doing that kind of an implementation where there is a movement of location, but they want to keep the location name same, you can use that feature of changing the location name, location country to a secondary location name, but primary location country you cannot change. You can give the location name and the code over here. And if there is an inventory organization attached to a location, you can put it here. This is the main address of the location. You can choose the country. Accordingly, the location address structure will be displayed. You can put the geography hierarchy over here. Now, I will show you how to create geography hierarchy. This is important because in that way you can show the top node of the geography tree and show how all the countries of your client fall under the geography, and you can put the phone fax and other phone information. This is good because if you attach the employee to a particular location, like this employee is working in this particular building which has this main phone, fax and other phone, then this information sits directly on the employee data. So if the HR is actually viewing the employee data by seeing the location, she can understand how to contact that employee. So even though these are not mandatory and we don't pay much attention in filling this up, but as a part of data cleansing, and you can give an advice to the client to fill these things, because in this way the information is centralized with the HR. I just got a question, if we can explain about the reference data set and common set in a bit more details. Surely, I think we are ending up with today's session. What I will do is I will create a slide with the common set and reference data set examples and show you in the next day's session. So I think I will finish this session today now. And if you have any question, you can ask me, or we can call it a day otherwise. One more thing I will just show to all of you who are seeing the application for the first time today. Whenever you go to any of the work structure screen, there is a create option, which is a plus symbol, and there is an export option. This export allows you to download all the information from the system. So what the way we do it is, suppose your client wants to see all the list of locations in the system, or you want to send it to the client what all structure you have created in the system in the form of an Excel sheet. Now, you don't need to go all the way to create a report for that or create an OTVI for that. You can go to advanced, click an advanced search with is not blank. And do a search. It will give you all the data that is stored in the system. And then if you click on this export option, it will download this data in the form of an Excel sheet in the system. So this thing you can do with everything, like your location, your department, your grade, positions. Okay, so this is how it gets downloaded. It has got the name, code, location, set, address, city, country, everything. Okay, so if you don't have any question, then I will just wind up the session, and tomorrow we will start with the example of the reference data set, and then we'll complete the rest of the topics. I think we have two more, we have until Friday to complete the entire training. And if you want to know anything more or any further example about what all topics we discussed today, you can let me know. You can mail me also so that I can create some examples and show you. Yeah, sure. I just got a question about the PPT and the Word doc. I'll send that to you. Rather, I will send it to Vidya once the training is over so that she can share with everyone. Okay then, thank you all for attending the session. We'll meet again tomorrow, same time.